Well, good morning. Great to see you all. Happy New Year. Since this is the, thank you. It's the first I've seen a lot of you in this new year, 2023. Hard to believe it. We're off and running. But it's great to see you all. Welcome to all those of you that are joining us online as well. Always are grateful when you take a second to let us know you're here. Connection cards for those of you that are here. Those of you that are with us online, give us a shout out in the message board. You can drop those connection cards and offering plate on your way out. We're always grateful when you take a moment to do that. Number of announcements for today. The kids' choir will not be rehearsing today. Our director is ill, but the bells will be rehearsing after worship today. Youth group's going to meet after worship today. They're going to have lunch. We're going to do a couple of duties real quick, and then we're going to have a heck of a lot of fun with my new toys. Anybody wants to stick around to play themselves, do so, or just check out Facebook and Twitter later on. You'll see some pictures. This is going to be a good time. Trustees are meeting after worship as well, and governing board's going to meet tomorrow, 7 o'clock. You can look for that Zoom link. Next Sunday, Loaves and Fishes Plus Pantry, and then please mark your calendars for Sunday, January 29th, for our annual soup cook-off. That's going to happen right after worship on the 29th, so get that marked off, and if you want to be a part of that, you can start making plans now as well. We are, you might be wondering, wow, they still got all their Christmas decor up. That's right, because Christmas just ended a couple of days ago, and I'm all Christmassy and nostalgic like that, so I said, leave them up. We're going to do Epiphany today, and so, and besides, I love a fully lit Advent wreath for as long as possible. So we're doing an Epiphany today, and then following worship, we'll begin to take things down. So if anybody wants to stick around and help bring some things down and get them to a particular place, that is of great help to Ann Halpin and her crew. So many hands, of course, make light work. So if you want to just spend a few minutes helping out, that will be greatly appreciated. And then if anybody wants any more poinsettias, you're welcome to take those following this time of worship as well. So please feel free. Take one, take two, take all of them, whatever you want. So it's all good. So that's what's happening in the life of the church. Please check your bulletin for more information. Please note, we are putting together a January-February Pathways. So that's going to be getting put together in the next several days. So if there's anything you want to have in the Pathways newsletter, please get that into the church office. And please do note that that's going to be through February. So if you're thinking, oh, I'll hit the next one, well, no, the next one's not going to be until March after this January, February one. So that's something I wanted everybody to be aware of. So on this Sunday, as we gather together again in this new year, even though it's the second Sunday of the new year, we do turn and familiarize ourselves once again with that wonderful old story of the Magi joining us and following that star and finding that babe, Jesus. And so let us focus ourselves again on that beautiful story. And let us do so as we worship. And let us continue to worship as we stand as you're able and join together in singing hymn number 151, The First Noel. Let us sing.
Thank you. Well, good morning, everybody. We welcome everyone into worship today, into this place of love and grace, into this place of hope and perseverance. We know that God invites all of us here to be part of this beloved community and to share together in his worship. And we know that we are welcome just as we are, and that we are loved by God's good grace. So let us join together today in worship, and let's join me right now in a prayer. Lord God, we thank you that you promise to be with us always. We thank you for your presence that is with us right now. Today we give of our hearts and our minds and our lives. Come speak your words of life into our beings. We pray that you would deepen our comprehension, broaden our thinking, and transform our understanding of what we are about to study. You are our wise counselor and our perfect teacher and faithful friend. Amen. So we've read in the Bible here in Colossians 3:15 that states that, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace." And as Christians, we're always called to this biblical peace that we want to share with others and be able to have that peace in our lives. And it's not always smooth sailing and easy going, but we know that we have that faith in ourselves, that internal peace that can weather the many storms that life throws at us. But finding that daily peace, as I mentioned, is not always the easiest thing to do. But we know that continuing to practice at it and making that effort to make it there is what will get us to that truthful peace that we look for and long for. So as we continue to practice here, take a warm smile, a shake of a hand, a pat on the back, and let's share the peace with one another this morning.
We invite our children for our children's message. Choir, thank you. I once saw a car with a bumper sticker that says, "I heart the old Latin mass." And there's proof why, right? Thank you. No joke, I really did see that bumper sticker. Well, how are you guys doing? Happy New Year. You guys excited for a new year? Everybody stay up and watch the ball drop?
Yes.
No? You got close, but you conked up. No fireworks woke you up. Very good. Well, who here likes puzzles? You guys like puzzles? Yeah? Do you guys like mazes?
Yeah.
Yeah?
That's kind of like a puzzle. You got
what?
You gotta move something to the center.
Yeah, or in this case, it looks like you actually start at the center in this one, and you try to find your way out. I printed off a whole bunch of these. This one, you gotta start up here, and you gotta try to get down to here, right? Same thing, right? I love mazes. Do you guys like mazes?
Yeah,
right?
Corn maze.
You like a corn maze? Who doesn't love a good corn maze, right? I'm with you, buddy. You could be eating corn while you're doing the corn maze. That's fantastic. Why have I never thought about it? I'm really good at corn mazes here in January, just so you know. So get it, because they've all been harvested. You just got to walk. All right, bad joke. All right, well, mazes, though, right? These things are a lot of fun, right? You got to find your way through it, right? But they can be kind of difficult, right? When you're in a maze, you got to figure out which way to go, and you got to change directions all the time, and sometimes you'll hit dead ends, right? And then sometimes you just have to, like, backtrack, and maybe sometimes you just got to go, oh, gosh, I'm just going to have to go back to the beginning and start all over, right? So sometimes mazes can be pretty tough and pretty frustrating. And even though finding the right path that leads to the finish may be difficult, if you stick to it and you try really hard, you eventually find your way through the maze, right?
I know how to walk to the end, but I know how to get
there. Yeah, all right, very good. So a little more than a week ago, as we said, we rang in 2023, right? And as we face each new day of this new year, we're trying what? To follow God's path, right? All throughout the year. And God wants us to follow God's path. And sometimes, though, that path that God wants us to follow can seem like a crazy maze, can it, right? It's not always such an easy straight line for us to take, right? We may face difficult choices in deciding what God wants us to do. We might have to make some frequent changes of direction that we thought we should go, but now all of a sudden, oh, we got to go a different direction, right? And sometimes we find that we've made a wrong choice and we went a wrong direction and we hit a dead end and we have to turn around and find our way back through, or maybe we even have to just start all over again. Following God's path is not always so easy, is it? We can't just go whoop and go through it, right? Because we say we're following God. But that's right. God does know the way through, right? And as long as we're faithful to God and we listen to God, right? And we're open to God's direction, we'll always find our way through, right? And we'll always be able to take that path that God would have us go. Yeah. So I'm going to let you guys take all those mazes with you once we're done here. And you can work on them if you want. And you can remember that even though getting through the maze that God has to guide us through, that we never go through this maze alone. God is always with us. Christ's light is always leading us. And we always have our faithful church family and friends to go through this maze too. Let's pray together. Dear God, as we travel through the new year, help us to follow your path. Amen. Thanks, guys. Here, take all those things. mm-hmm.
Every day we are called by Christ to respond in some way. And it was just noted there, obviously some days it's more of a maze than others. But the more practice that we have at listening to those calls and how we respond to those calls that God places in front of us, the easier it is for us to discern what it is that He is asking of us to accomplish. And when we begin to hear that call, then it's our choice of how we respond. And yes, God has given us free will to allow us to make our own choices. And we may choose not to respond to those calls or try to figure out the maze that He has set before us. But if we continue to choose to say yes on those calls, that can lead us here to mature our faith. So as we are confronted daily with the different mazes that we may have or the different calls that the Lord places in front of us, ask us or challenge us to say yes to those calls. And however that is that you say yes in giving of your time, your talents, your efforts, or even simply lending a helping hand to somebody that you see is in need. We know that we have our electronic giving that can be placed through the church website, as well as the offertory plates in the back. And you're able to also sign up with your connection card. Put your name down. Sign up. I'd love to have some good soup here at the end of the month for our soup cook-off. I'll volunteer to be a judge if you're needed. There's my talents, giving of the taste buds. So, as we have our stewardship challenge here, let's join together in singing our offertory hymn here. Stand as you are able. Accept, O God, the gifts we bring. God of calm and content, we offer our humble gifts and the service of our lives in the hope that they will be pleasing to you. We pray that your blessing, that they will produce a harvest of peace, healing, and love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
As we look to remember and honor and celebrate that day of Epiphany, we turn to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And we hear again that beloved and faithful story of the Magi. Matthew tells us, in the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? We have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the good news. Thanks be to God. One of the great missionaries of the last century, E. Stanley Jones, said, "The Christian faith is not a set of propositions to be accepted. It is a person to be sought and followed." I'll say that again. The Christian faith is not a set of propositions to be accepted. It is a person to be sought and followed. Now, I can't be certain, of course, but I have to wonder, when Jones made this statement, if he had just read Matthew 2, 1 through 12. This familiar and beloved story of Christmas is richly layered with tradition, wonder, majesty, and seasonal sentiments. But still woven within this story are layers of atrocity and warning. But then still there are layers of visions that show us undeniably a faithful path forward, and that sometimes the faithful path forward means going a different way. I know I'm a few days late with this text, the Christmas season having just ended on Thursday, but while I may lack liturgical succinctness, I still am liturgical. And it's okay to be a little late because we all love this story, right? Even if much of what we love and much of what we think we know about this story comes only from how culture has shaped this story and not so much of what actually was. Yep, you guessed it. This is the part where I once again ruin that beloved Christmas hymn, "We Three Kings." I've done it before, and I'm not afraid to do it again. We don't know how many wise men there were. Church tradition says there were three, but that's because of verse 11, which says, "They bowed down and worshiped him. They opened their treasures and presented him gifts of gold and incense and myrrh." It does not say a gift of gold was open, then a gift of incense, and finally a gift of myrrh. So who knows? Maybe there were five kings with gold, two with incense, and 27 with myrrh. Who knows? We don't know how many magi there were, and we don't know if they were kings or scholars or astronomers or astrologers. But though we don't know exactly how many, we do know how they came and how they went. And since I'm ruining beloved Christmas songs, I might as well spoil another and tell you, nowhere in the Gospels is there a little drummer boy. I'm sorry, he's not there, okay? Some people have debated me on that. So what do we know for certain about these magi? We know they came from a great distance. Magi from the east came to Jerusalem. This expression "from the east" means outside of Palestine, way beyond the borders of known travel. "From the east" also means beyond the arena of God's truth, beyond the boundaries of God's people, beyond the promised land where people had no idea who God was. The Magi were spiritually hungry seekers, searching the stars night after night in hopes of finding answers, in hopes of finding a truth that was worth living for. Meaning the Magi were Gentiles. They were pagans without religious affiliation. And so their journey gives testimony to who Jesus was, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to the people of Israel. And then we can add in, because of the gifts they brought, and because they traveled such a long distance, it was likely a huge caravan. Caravan of servants and camels carrying all the needed supplies for a long journey. A huge caravan that would have generated a lot of attention. Certainly everyone in Jerusalem knew of their arrival. Which meant, of course, as we heard, good old King Herod knew of their arrival too. These Magi, these hungry seekers of this profound revelation, enter Jerusalem and they ask, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star and we've come to worship him." Even asking this question of Herod himself, unaware of what kind of person he was. Which becomes a testimony then to the size of their entourage and the influence Herod must have perceived them to have, because Herod didn't have them immediately arrested and put to death. Because here's the thing. We know Herod was a bad guy. But we may not realize just how bad he really was. Herod was an egomaniac and a sociopath. He lived a lavish lifestyle and bankrupt Judah with his extravagant building projects. He built shrines to idols and all sorts of God, not because he believed in them, but rather just in case there was favor to be gained from them. He lived in constant fear of a coup, which influenced murderous impulses, including toward a wife, sons, and a mother-in-law. Herod was the declared king of the Jews and expected any worship being offered to the king of the Jews be offered to him. All of this is when the Magi don't return with the information that he asked for. And then things really got out of hand, because Herod began hunting this newborn king with reckless and murderous abandon, killing all the male babies in Bethlehem under the age of 2. Like the Magi, who were hungry seekers searching for a truth worth living for, Herod was too a hungry seeker, seeking to stay king. And Herod knew no other way to remain king than by doing so with violence and atrocity. When Herod meets with and then sends these Magi to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. As soon as you find him, come and tell me so that I may go and worship him." It all becomes then an important convergence and divergent that takes place. Both parties were brought together because both were seeking the exact same thing. Herod was, of course, wasn't going to go and worship the newborn king. He wasn't interested in finding a savior. Herod was only interested in eliminating his rival. But the Magi, they were searching. They were searching faithfully, searching for something that was beyond themselves, something they knew was worth a long journey, worth all of the costs, worth the risks, because they knew this event that was happening, this birth, was going to change everything. And the search continued until finally the Magi found what they were looking for. They found the truth that for their entire lives had been absent. And because they had, everything was different. Everything was changed. And what was now most important and now most changed was themselves. They got it. And because they got it, God warned them in a dream to avoid Herod, who didn't get it. And then they went home a different way. Herod sought to destroy his rival. But the Magi were seeking something beyond themselves. And because they were, they did go home different. A way that kept a safe distance from Herod, but also a different way because they were leaving as different people from when they arrived. For all the awful things we can say about King Herod, he does actually offer a great piece of advice for us. He says, "Go and search diligently for the child." He says this to lifelong seekers on a journey to find the truth. But he could have just as easily been saying it to you or me. Go and search diligently for the child, because once you find the child, everything changes. Once you search diligently, find, and then permit the newborn king to rule in your heart, to lead you in the path of life, you will undoubtedly be going a different way. The Magi return home by another way to avoid Herod, but it is symbolic of what meeting Jesus does. Jesus sends you home different. You go through life a completely different way. By meeting Jesus, experiencing his glory and power, and learning he is going to be the Savior of the world, then there is no other option than to go a different way. You're a different person because you've met Jesus. You are forever changed because you met Jesus. Now, I haven't said anything here that all of you don't already know. The story, this message, this truth of meeting Jesus and going a different way, all of it we know. So why read this story again? Why share this message again? Why hold up this truth again? We hear it all again because today we are the Magi. And we need to realize and embrace this truth. We have been journeying through Advent and Christmas, being led by the lights of the world to once again receive the gift of Jesus. And because we have, we can't just box it all up. We can't just box up the tree and the ornaments and the decorations and be through the holidays. We can't just go back. We have to go forward a different way. This is true for us as individuals, but it is especially true for us as a church in 2023. And we're going to get deeper into why this is true and important for us as a church in 2023 next week. E. Stanley Jones said, "The Christian faith is not a set of propositions to be accepted. It is a person to be sought and followed." The Magi sought and followed. And by doing so, they had an encounter with the divine that would have them going a different way. A way that changed them forever. Amen. Friends, let us join our hearts together again and go to God in prayer. And as we do so, let us hold in our prayers Jean Lamont. Jean's been having a rough period lately in his need of our prayers. Please keep in your prayers our Director of Youth Ministries, Katie Taylor. Katie will be having much-needed surgery later this week, so please keep Katie in your prayers as she goes into the surgery and throughout her recovery. And let us give thanks and rejoice and give praise to God for Ann and Dan Ryman and their family as they have welcomed into this world earlier this week. their third son. He was born on Tuesday, Phineas Jonah Ryman. He joins big brothers Charlie and Theo, who are no doubt thrilled about having little brother Finn join them. So much to keep in our prayers. Let us pray. Holy God, weeks ago it was Thanksgiving. The next day we unpacked the holly, the mistletoe, the nativity. And now, if we haven't already, we'll repack the baby Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, the stable, the animals, and all the other decorations, and put them away for another year. We've gone back to work. Christmas is over. But that is not what you would have from us, O God. You would not have us just let it end. You want Christmas to continue on and on, in us, through us. So the light of Christmas shines on. So the hope, peace, joy, and love of Christmas continues. This is what we want too. So we pray you would bless us again with your grace, that we might continue to carry Christmas, not just for a season, not just for 12 days, but all year long. For truly your Son came to be with us, not for a few weeks, but for our entire lives. Gracious and loving God, as we begin a new year, as individuals and especially as a church, help us to discern what calls us and what moves us. Open our eyes to see the needs of our community. Open our ears to hear your call, and open our hearts to be filled by the Holy Spirit. Grant us the courage to use the gifts and talents you have blessed us with to do the work you would have us do. Continue to build this community of faith, strengthening our bonds with one another and with you. Help us to support and encourage one another in our common ministry, that is to share the good news of your Son. Do that in us and through us. And we are certain this new year and the different ways you would have us go will be a blessing to us and a blessing to others. May you listen now, Holy God, to the prayers of our hearts offered in this time of holy silence. All this we pray in the name of the light of the world, Emmanuel, the Prince of Peace, Christ Jesus, the Messiah, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let us gather around our Lord's table, and let us do so as we sing together that still beloved hymn of the church, We Three Kings. I'll fully admit I do love that song myself. And I do love the little drummer boy as well. No disrespect there. It's just not in the Gospels. And I love all the characters of Christmas. George Bailey, Ebenezer Scrooge, even Clark Griswold. And they're all a part of the Christmas season. And that's okay because they make our Christmas season filled with joy. Because we go to them over and over again. It's part of it. And that joy still, though, comes from that Christ child, who we still seek all throughout the Advent and Christmas seasons. Seeking Him because we are seeking something beyond ourselves. And all of it is good and right. Because in all of it, we remember what this season is filled with. It's filled with hope, peace, joy, and love. It's filled with the light of the world. And it leads us to remember who brings that. And it leads us to this place where we again remember what we have been brought. The light of the world and the promise of grace and forgiveness and eternal life. It all comes together. And it all comes back to Jesus. It comes back to Jesus who on that night before He was crucified, gathered with His disciples to share a meal. And during that meal, He took a loaf of bread and He blessed it and He broke it and He gave it to His disciples, saying to them, "Take and eat of this, all of you. For this is My body broken for you. Take and do this in remembrance of Me." In like manner, Jesus took a cup and gave it to His disciples and said to them, "Take and drink from this, all of you. For this cup is My shed blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink and do this in remembrance of Me." Friends, we do this in remembrance because we are seeking that which is beyond ourselves. So let all come to this table who are seeking and let them find once again that which is beyond ourselves. And find it here, the gifts of God for the children of God.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, just as You guided the Magi to find Jesus in Bethlehem, we ask that You guide us to this table to receive its gifts that will nourish our soul so we may go forwards and follow Your guiding hand and fulfill the love, peace, and hope that You ask us to have. Amen.
Well, at Advent, we were seeking hope, peace, joy, and love. On Christmas Eve, we came seeking the light of Christ, and on Epiphany, we come seeking a truth that is beyond ourselves, a truth that changes everything. So let us consider now how we will continue to go forward, how we will continue to move in a different way. And let us consider such as we stand as you're able and join together in singing our hymn of invitation, hymn number 174, Brightest and Best. Let us sing. Seekers of something. Some seek the light and truth as found in Christ Jesus. Some are seeking something that maybe they can't put a name to. But all of us are seeking. So let us go forth having sought and found what we were seeking. Let's go forth a different way, ready to share what we have found in any way we can, so that those who are seeking might see in us a glimmer of what they are seeking. Maybe they'll ask us about it. Maybe they'll want to know more. Maybe they'll want to know how they can find what we found. Maybe then that we offer them some direction, some invitation. Maybe find their way here on a Sunday morning, or find us online, or simply to follow the light that they have begun to see. However we share that invitation to those who are seeking, let us do so faithfully. And let us go forth to do so. And as you do, may the grace of God, the constant and abiding presence of the Holy Spirit, and the unconditional love of Jesus Christ rest and abide with each and every one of you, now and forevermore. Amen.
yourself.